part of this day of debate and discussion about independent workers and industrial relations in Europe. One technical just to mention before I forget, if you did not register, please do so at the break at the front desk. So we're sure that you came and you attended our event. So just at the front desk you can register and you can also receive a badge with your name on it and the institution you are representing. So we're very pleased to welcome you at SMART today for this debate about the independent workers and industrial relations. Things are changing a lot, things are evolving a lot, and we are honored to welcome you here at SMART to discuss about this. Also, Sandrino Gassefa, the CEO of SMART, couldn't be here today, so he asked me if I could give you a little word of introduction to welcome you here. As we are a little bit late, I'm going to be very straightforward and give quickly the word to the speakers that will take the floor after me. Like I said, things are evolving a lot. You have seen the figures, iWire, that more and more workers, independent workers, are coming now all over countries in Europe and all over the world. And SMART is also changing a lot. We were 20 years ago offering service mostly to one type of workers, and 20 years later we are welcoming many types of independent workers from many sectors, and also we have changed our structure. So we are here at the COP, which is the place where we welcome everybody that wants to come to SMART to just take some advice and take benefiting from the service that SMART can offer. And SMART has been now created as a cooperative, and we're welcoming more and more people, and this will be a good day to discuss about all this evolution in the last years. So I give the word to Renata. I wish you a great day of debate, discussion, and thank you very much for coming.
Caspar, head of the sector for the European Sectoral Social Dialogue, for the welcome of the European Commission.
Thank you, Renata. Welcome. Thank you for the invitation. I'm now replacing my head of unit, who was in a very short notice unable to join this meeting today. But anyway, I'm very happy to be here, and I'm also. It pleases me really that to see that so many people are thinking about how to organize independent workers and how to provide them with an access to social dialogue. Because, actually, this is an important feature of industrial relations to be able to join the social dialogue. And the lucky thing this time is that social dialogue is not just something for a few people somewhere at the margins of everyday work. With this local commission, you can say about it what you want, but social dialogue is one of its priorities. He has, recalled that several times, and we have done this, I think it was the first major conference under this term. A big conference to relaunch social dialogue where we brought together all the social partners, top level social partners all over Europe. Having said this, and then expecting that everything would be nice for industrial relations and everything would work well, we did stay. Because this president has also a certain level of saying this is my thing and this is not my thing, and he has a strong understanding that there is a considerable autonomous dimension to social dialogue, which means bipartite, the social partners have to do something. There has to be a negotiation between the two sides of the industry. And this only happens if you really manage to organize both sides. And organizing workers, employees or self-employed, and employers is getting more and more difficult. That is what we see in our everyday life, where we are working in the sectors where we see that on the side of employers as well as employees, it's getting really difficult to get a decent level of participation all over Europe and in some member states in particular. Having said this, Juncker and the Commission is of course also willing to try, and we have to do our part. It's not that it's only to the social partners, there is also a part to be done by the Commission, which is to involve social partners much more systematic and more in depth in consultation processes, in policy making. This we basically do by giving increased attention to social partners' role in the European semester process, but also in the dedicated policy initiatives, where the Commission so far has done more than it would actually have been obliged to do over the last years. Dedicated high-level hearings, dedicated meetings to discuss certain topics. It might not sound immediately have an impact on this specific initiative. The advantage being more that there is a discourse going on. And as you are scientists, I think you also understand that the importance of an ongoing dialogue, of an ongoing discussion between high-level policymakers, so from the government side, and high-level social partners to actually exchange these views and to say, how can we make the views of the world in a coherent way, or how can we ensure that there is a coherence between the different ways of thinking. And all this, as you might know, might not know, has led to the social pillar, which we had also, I think it was in 2016, a very extensive discussion on how it could be. 2017 it was published, and now we are basically in a period where this social pillar should become a sort of reality. And also here again, this focus is put on yes, Commission tries to provide a framework, and we try, and we have launched a number of initiatives which try to give or aim at giving Europe a more social perspective, but there is also a lot to be done by the different parties. And in that sense, it has to be a joint effort. And joint effort meaning the Commission has to continue the work along what we have done already now. The working time, experimental communication, we had done the written statement directive, proposal for a revision of the written statement directive, meaning now it's a proposal for a directive on transparent and predictable working conditions, which would, I think, exactly aim at people who are somewhere between being decently employed and being decently self-employed. Does somebody actually qualify for employment? Be notified about its working conditions. And then we have a recommendation only this week, earlier on the Tuesday, the recommendation on access to social security, which
2 days ago,
exactly.
It's happening the right moment.
Yeah, I think the timing was perfect. And then we had understood originally we had thought it would be on the 7th, but then we said, no, this iWire conference is only on the 16th, so we can't go on the 7th. No way. Which it's a proposal for a council recommendation, and the recommendation would foresee that there is an opt-out social obligatory social security coverage for most social security schemes, which would mean that national authorities, because social security is a national competence, are obliged to give self-employed people a coverage under the social security schemes, per default, that there is anything that any self-employed would be covered, unless he says, no, I don't want to be covered. And not the other way around, which would be an opt-in scheme saying, oh, you can have if you join. This you can have if you join requires more on the side of the employee or on the side of the worker to actually say, yes, I want to be part of it. And this decision, I want to be part of it, is considered as not the right way, because we all know that there are quite a number of people who say this is transitory and right now I need the money and I don't want to pay contributions and it's so much of a hassle to get into it and I have to complete application forms and en masse. No, I don't join later. And then you lose year after year and your coverage is bad. The idea is to say, no, no, you are, for a start, you are a member, you contribute and you are benefiting. And then you have to declare if you want to get out of it. And a special role will be for the unemployment scheme. So I think there are some efforts going on. There are some moves on the side of the commission. Now we have to make sure that there will also be some move on the side of the member state. And I think, I have a strong feeling there is also something to be done on the side of the social partners. And also the independent, and this is really a hell of a task, have to get organized. And there is a certain level, and I think you have it also in your report, there is a long, by now 50, 60, 100 years, depends, I don't know how long it goes back, you have probably researched it, a tradition of individualization of these workers, getting more individual, getting more specific, which always makes it difficult to actually start in a what seems to be a backward step to be solidarity, to show solidarity with colleagues and to join a group or to subscribe to something. I think this is nowadays no longer en vogue. And in that sense, I will be very happy to actually listen to your discussions, and I'm sure also my colleague had, we discussed it yesterday, and we said, yes, yes, I'm very keen to hear that, because how do you actually, what do you do, what can we do to ensure that self-employed, that workers do engage in a sort of trade union, that they are starting to join, let's put it like that, not necessarily trade union, but a club, an association where they have to pay a fee and where they get something out of it. How are there any examples out there? We are right now writing on a report which is called ESDE, so Employment and Social Developments in Europe. The focus this year is social dialogue and beyond in a digitalized way. Social dialogue in a digitalized world, or in a world of new forms of work. How do we do it? I think we both hope, my colleague Katarina and me, that we get a few inspiration from the discussions you have today. In that sense, I'm curious to listen. I'm attentively listen. And I wish you all the best and very successful discussion. And I think your results will be important for the union. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much, Sigrid, for your intervention and for stressing the new commitment that the European Commission is demonstrating recently with a more powerful than in the past in this direction. So I have the task to present the project. It is my pleasure to introduce the project iWire, Independent Workers and Industrial Relations in Europe, the social dialogue between traditional and innovative forms of collective representation, which is going to end after 2 years and was made possible through the joint efforts of all the partners of this project. And the core activities of the project have included three European workshops and this final conference. And I thank very much SMART and Sarah in particular for the excellent organization of the final phase of this 2 years project. And it's our hope, of course, that this project can contribute to advancing the debate on the autonomous work in Europe and the social needs and the collective representation of the independent or self-employed professionals. And we gratefully acknowledge the support of the European Commission to the project. So this is the final moment of the project. So for me, I'm very satisfied of the work that you carried on, and really I hope that can contribute to the debate. So I start in saying what we consider relevant in this study. So what is the relevance of the study? So since the 90s, there has been a renewed attention to self-employment due to some crucial changes that are transition to service economies, disruptive power of digital capitalism, the increase of high skill, flexible and hyper-specialized professionals, and spread of individual bargaining connected to the individualization of the working condition. In other words, the self-employed status is being more and more used, widely used, than before. So, however, we can find some ambiguity of this process of the increase of new skills and new professionals and these autonomous workers, and we can have that offers opportunities and risks. So, from one side, there are more autonomy and self-determination in this kind of work. But at the other end, we can find that the old risk of their activities on individual basis and growing instability of the professional careers, in terms that there is a growing number of people that is accumulating in parallel several employment contracts and also marginal activities. So, We know that the literature shows us several critics that have stressed the dominance of the market element over the social one, and the prevalence of the market element instead of privilege the social one and the social inclusion of these workers. So, this ambiguity is well represented by the new independent workers. So we consider them as paradigmatic examples of this second generation of self-employment, and as Sergio Bologna has said, since 2007, and the high skills such as interpreters, consultants, trainers, IT specialists, artists, translators, analysts, accountants, etc., because there are a lot of professional comprised in this group of independent professionals who mainly belongs to non-regulated professions and works in the advanced service sector. So we consider the person that are principally in non-regulated professions and working in the service. In the service sector. This ambiguity is, kind of worker is also emblematic and paradigmatic of the new interplay between internal and internal labor market, between insider and outsider. So, it represents something that is disrupt in a sense, confuse the main theoretical model to interpret labor market dynamics. And are
workers that are in between, between market and hierarchy, between insider and outsider. This is from the sociological point of view, that is my view, very interesting, because really they represent something that is new. Because it's renew, make disorder in the more static paradigm of the labor market theory and segmentation theory and dualization of labor market. Even if we don't have nowadays a new strong paradigm able to substitute the old one. We don't have, for now, a general paradigm able to interpret the social change related to the labor market transformation. So we know that these groups of people constitute an heterogeneous group of professionals that includes both intellectual and technical profession, different working condition and employment relation depending on the type of contract. So we know that these groups are not homogeneous, are very heterogeneous in terms of skills, in terms of sectors. They are similar in the fact they are not mainly not regulated professions and they work in the service sector. But we have a lot of differences between them. And we have different working conditions, okay? High income inequality and variability. And disparities in the access to social protection due to the labor market status. The status of these workers, legally speaking, is crucial.